She was a really nice, decent human being. She had a tremendous sense of humour. Could laugh at anything. Absolutely brilliant with her three children. I would say me and Karen were more like sisters than a mother and a daughter. We really could talk about anything.
Karen Bedford was 36 years old, newly married and a devoted mother. She was looking forward to the future.
She married her second husband on the 14th of December. You look at those photographs and you can't imagine that 9 weeks and one day later, she left this world, because she did look really well. But she had a back problem. Her third baby was nearly a year old, and we thought it could be the strain of the pregnancy and the birth and everything. So she just bit her lip and carried on. So anyway, we made the wedding, but I remember that she did have to sit down because it would have been too painful to have stood for long. And she got through the day.
But Karen's condition worsened, and hospital tests revealed devastating results. Cancer, which began in her lungs, had spread like a fire through her body.
This was a girl that had never smoked. Ultra fit. No weight on her. Baffling.
As the cancer took hold, it became clear that Karen needed the special kind of care that only a hospice can give. In fact, one in three of us will rely on the services they provide at some time during our lives, whether for ourselves or a loved one. At St. Kentigan Hospice, here in the cathedral city of St. Asaph, end-of-life care is about dignity, comfort, and support for the whole family. And the wishes of the patient are at the heart of everything we do.
Lee was actually quite afraid. Oh, I've heard this is where people come to die. Yes, it is. But it's going to be okay. And you can already feel the lad relaxing and saying, this is like a lounge at home, Shirl. Yes, yes, it is. And already that woolly, woolly blanket is starting to wrap around you. I hate to think what would have happened to us as a family if there'd been no room at the inn. Weren't we lucky?
We have the whole sort of gamut of cancer diagnoses, but we also have people who have other terminal illnesses. So people who are in sort of terminal heart failure or the last stage of kidney disease or last stage of lung disease. Anybody who is at those last stages of their life, really, in the inpatient unit, in the daycare patient unit. We're looking at people who've got a life-threatening illness, but they may not be dying in months, maybe not even years, but they do have that sort of diagnosis and do need that specialist care and support that we can give.
For some patients, living day to day with the effects of a life-threatening illness can be a lonely and depressing experience. Many visit the hospice once or twice a week for a range of therapies and support that aren't always available elsewhere.
It's like a release valve to me, where I can let out all my feelings and speak about it openly, which you can't do at home. Like, if you're worried about upsetting anyone and that, this is just, you just say it as it is. I can't emphasise that enough to people, how helpful they've been here to me personally, but to all the other people as well. It's an amazing place.
I can have a massage if I want one. I can have a shower if I want one. They'll help me and do it for me. It's worth every penny. The staff, they're angels, and they have been that.
Because I suffer from depression with having the cancer, and I just lost all interest in everything. But this has made it a little bit better for me.
When you're at home, you always fear the worst, think the worst when anything goes wrong. And here they just talk you through and you find it's normal or something like that. Yeah, it's a lifeline.
I love coming here to meet the ladies as well, because we've made some friends, haven't we? And I'm going to cry, so stop it. I am.
Death is still a taboo subject. Anybody who doesn't have anything to do with hospices have great misconceptions about hospice care and the dying process. The whole ethos of a hospice is that it is as much as we possibly can make it within reasonable boundaries, as much like home as it possibly can be. We've had a couple of weddings here which have been extremely emotional, where people have wanted to, you know, to get married before they die. Everybody in this world dies, but it's such a sort of critical and important part of somebody's existence, and to be, I just feel that it is a privilege just to be there.
You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
You can't put a price on care like this. But the fact is that more than 80% of St Kentigan's running costs are donated. Our services are free to every patient who needs them. But without your donations, many families would have to cope alone.
You hear these terrible stories, don't you, about people struggling in pain because their morphine's not right or their drugs aren't right. But we never had that because we were in the right place. To have that professionalism around you at that time, for you and your family, it's phenomenal. We were so warm in there and so looked after. And Karen had died, and you're thinking, we've now got to leave the building. Do you know, we didn't want to leave the building. That was a big world out there. And I really didn't want to leave that building. None of us did. When you think, you know, that Lee was so frightened going in. And you know, they didn't sweep us out with the rubbish. They did give us time. They absolutely, they said, another cup of tea, take your time. How wonderful is that? She left a marvellous legacy. These three children are quite stunning. And they're going to do her proud.
More than